My name is Harry Olmer, and I was born in Poland, Sosnowiec, in 1927. My parents had a business, or my father had a business actually making boots for the local cavalry regiment, who was stationed not very far from our place, and all the officers who used to come to the place to have their riding boots made at the time. And that was in 1939, when the war started on the 1st of September. We thought that the Germans would come in very, very quickly, but it didn't. On the Sunday, on the 3rd of September, my father decided we should leave the town and make our way down to a small town near Krakow, where my grandmother lived. He had two of his brothers living there as well, and that's what we did. We got on the train, but after about half an hour's journey, German planes came overhead and they bombed the train. We managed to get off unscathed and we made our way on foot. It took us 4 days to get to my grandmother's, and when we got there, of course, everything was still normal, although the Germans moved in as well, but because a small town, they did only left just a few German soldiers behind. And we stayed there with my grandmother and my two uncles there as well, because there were six of us. We had two older sisters. I had my one brother, and we had two younger sisters as well. And we stayed with them for about a month there. And at the end of the month in October, after the Jewish holidays, we made our way back to Sosnowiec, back to our hometown. And when we got there, actually, the place was in a dreadful state. All the synagogues and all the people actually walking around in the street were completely desolate. The synagogues were demolished, either they bombed or they were burned. The people had been dispossessed from their homes as well. There were lots of Germans actually living in my town, and they helped themselves to whatever they wanted. The winter came in, and it was very, very hard winter. Although it was a mining district, we couldn't get any coal actually there or so, because all the coal was being shipped into Germany. So we had to do whatever we can in order to keep actually warm. Eventually, towards the end of the winter, we had to start breaking up our own furniture actually in order to keep warm. But by the spring, my father decided we should leave Sosnowiec for good. And we made our way down to where my grandmother lived. It was an agricultural place, and he came from that area as well, so he knew everybody there, and that's what he did. We got most of the possessions that we had, no furniture, but we had a lot of leather in his workshop. He got his leather and put it down on a cart, and we drove it down to where my grandmother lived and deposited actually in a farm, a very friendly farmer. And that's how we stayed there. Obviously, but then we had to do various works for the Germans, so the Jewish committee was set up in the town, and they had a list sent to them every day how many Jews they need in order to perform certain jobs for the Germans. Some jobs were very, very arduous, repairing roads or breaking up the stones in order to make them smaller to fill in the potholes. And in the winter, it was sweeping the snow from the roads. Other times, it wasn't quite so bad. One day, I remember I was being sent to a forest in order to plant saplings to replace the trees that were cut down. And it was a beautiful, beautiful day. And we really enjoyed that work there. But then after about half an hour, somebody came outside of the forest and he called out on a megaphone that everybody has got to get down to town. And we took our time. We knew what's going to happen when we get down to the town. Obviously the Germans are waiting for us. And that's exactly what happened. When we got down there, the Germans were very impatient and I was hit over the head with a lead-tipped whip. We were loaded on trucks, and we were taken away. We didn't know where. My parents, the whole family, didn't know where we went. but we deposited in about 8, maybe 10 miles away from our home in a brick factory. And that was very hard work. We had to go down to the clay pits, dig the clay out, lift it up to the roads, and push the carts with the clay into the factories to be made the bricks we made. And at night it was impossible to sleep because it was just a Nissen hut. In the hot in the summer, the hut was so hot we could hardly touch it actually as well. So the sleeping arranged accommodation was very, very bad. Anyway, I didn't stay there very long. I ran away from there. I knew exactly where to go, and the area was familiar to me as well. And I went back home, and that's how it was then. And until 1942, it would have been reasonable to live. Food wasn't plentiful, but it was adequate. My second oldest sister, she was taken away as well, and she had to be sent to Krakow to the airport to work there. But she could communicate with us, so we knew exactly where she was, and she said she was working in the kitchen. So we thought we should be perfectly all right. But then in 1942, that's when the real Holocaust started. And end of August, the notices pinned up throughout the town that the Jewish people have got to go to certain assembly points, and that the following day, and all we can take with us is a small suitcase and whatever food we've got. And that's what we did. I was still in the house, and there was an old man living directly opposite us, and his wife was a blind wife, and he knew he was not going to go anywhere. So he went out to the well, which was in the middle of the square of the where we lived, was a well, got a bucket of water, and as he was carrying the bucket of water home, a German soldier came in. We were watching him actually through the window. He was eating an apple. He took his gun out and he shot him. And we knew exactly what to do when we saw what happened. We made our way out of our house very quickly down to the assembly points. When we got down to the assembly points, there were already selections, only men, not women. And they took away, irrespective, some of them were older people, of course, but very many people they took away. And we didn't know where they were going. And then we were loaded on the trucks as well. We followed in the same direction as they did. And as we were driving past a small wood, we could hear a lot of shooting going on there. And of course, we knew what was happening to the men who were taken away earlier. And one of the women in our truck, she really started crying and screaming. Well, the Germans stopped the truck, pulled it down, and they shot her. So to calm everybody down. And we continued on our journey there towards Krakow, but we didn't go all the way to Krakow. We went to a place called Somniki. That's where my mother's family came from. And there the trucks turned off the main road, and we were deposited on a field, an open field. And we were the first ones to arrive in that field, and we could see Polish men digging trenches right around that field. And we thought that probably that's where our end is going to come. But gradually more and more people turned up on that field. Eventually there must have been about 2,000 people there. And there was a railway line next door to it as well. And we stayed on that field for 4 days. Whatever food we managed to bring with us went moldy very quickly because we were very damp then. And on the fourth day, all the women, young or old, and all the children were herded into those cattle trucks that were placed out on the railway line next to the field. And so that's the last time I saw my mother and my sisters, my grandmother, and some of my uncles as well. They all pushed into the big wagons, and the wagons stayed there until there was a selection then of the men. And the men, we had to walk past the Germans with our palms of our hands showing. And if we had calluses on our hands, then we kept to one side to obviously to see that they be capable of work. All the others, actually, who were not selected for work, were pushed into the wagons together with the women and the children. Another train arrived later on, and we were loaded on the train, and we made our way on the short distance. We went to Krakow. Outside Krakow, we went to the first concentration camp. It was Plaszów. You maybe have seen it, actually, the film of the Schindler's List. Actually, that was where it was filmed. And then we arrived there. All we had to, the first day we had to do was go and work for the building an embankment. And the embankment was built, all the contractors were still companies that are actually in being now, Hochtief, which is a very large construction company from Germany all over the world, and Siemens, big science actually were pinned up again to notify actually who's building that embankment there for the railway line. And when my father wanted to find out, because my younger sister was in the hospital when all that people actually were being sent away, and she didn't know what was happening to her, so my father ran away from the camp, and then my brother ran away from the camp as well, and they said we'd go back to see that my young sister is still there in the hospital. And so he went back there, and he was in hospital, so he took her out, and he made his way to where we used to live, because his young brother was left behind by the Germans to clear out all the empty homes that were left by the Jewish people. So he went back there, and then my brother ran away as well, and then a cart, small man, a Polish man actually, was sent up to the camp as well, and to see whether he can rescue me as well from there. And as we were walking back from work, the man actually was walking just parallel with us. He called out my name, and I just looked around. He walked up to me, and he took my hand. We walked away. Fortunately, we were still wearing, we didn't have any special uniforms, but we were saved, and we managed to get away. And he took me back home, and of course I was with my father, my uncles, my sister, and my brother as well. But again, after 1 week, we went out looking for some food in a farm, and then the Germans started rounding up the remainder of the Jews. We were taken into my brother left there at the barn, and I left half an hour later, but we were both picked up, and we were put into a small jail, and then the following day, I was sent back to Plaszów, but my brother wasn't sent back to Plaszów, so I didn't know where he went. And of course, that's how work started in Plaszów for me as well, the same type of work, going to the embankment, and the conditions there in the camp were absolutely horrendous. We had no banks, individual banks, we had like platforms, three different platforms, we had to sleep next to one another. And we got infected very, very quickly with lice and bed bags. It was absolutely horrendous. And the food after 12-hour shift work was, when we got back from work in the evening, that was our main meal, was cabbage soup, and we got a lump of bread. That lump of bread was supposed to last you for 24 hours. And in the morning, early in the morning, all we got was what they called ersatz coffee, just a black water, hot water. And that's all we got actually for the next day. But we managed to survive somehow. One day, I couldn't stand it any longer, actually being infected, being eaten, so to speak, by the lice and the bed bugs. And I got off my bunk in the middle of the night, and I went up to the shower, cold showers, and I switched on the lights, and I walked into the shower room and started having a shower. And then, of course, the Germans saw the light went up and sort of came rushing in. And I had two Alsatian dogs, and I thought they were going to let the dogs loose on me, but he was taken aback, and he saw me having a shower, and he turns around to all the Jewish policemen who were walking with him, and he says, dust ist Sauberkeit, that is cleanliness. And he walked out. I didn't dare do a thing like this anymore again. And that's how it was. But then after a little while, then the typhus epidemic erupted now in camp as well. And I was taken ill as well. And there was no medication. The only thing we had was just plenty of water and hydration. That's all we had. But no people died, of course, naturally. And but fortunately, I recovered. And I was there. And after 15, and after a year in Plasov, we were sent to Skarzysko, a munitions factory. The munitions factory was in the middle of Poland, and there were factories A, B, and C, and the C was the factory where I was placed to. We looked through the gates, and there were everything was yellow there, absolutely yellow. The people were walking around in sacks, more or less, and everything was yellow. But I drove in there, and I was assigned to a hut which was just about outside the washrooms. There were no shower rooms there, outside the washrooms, and there was the terrible smell there. I asked the people who were in the hut already what was the terrible smell, and he says all the bodies that die, all the people who died that in a week, they put the bodies into that box and they leave them there for a whole week before they come and collect them actually to take them away. It was absolutely decomposed bodies like lying about. The place I was placed to work actually was Pickering as well, and that was me, gave you the building, filling the bombs with Pickering acid and making mines, land mines and sea mines. And again, the selections were there every day, every day. People used to be taken away. If you didn't dare report that you're not well, if you didn't go well, then, you know, there used to be a place called, they used to call it the Patelnia in Polish, which is a frying pan. You used to take them into the wood, they used to shoot them. And then in the 1945, we thought we were going to be liberated because the Russians were already in Poland, and we could hear the artillery duels between the Russians and the Germans, and we really thought it was going to be a liberation. But the Russians stopped there, and they obviously went somewhere else, and so they evacuated half the camp, and the other camp was still there, still producing actually the bombs, filled them with explosives, and then eventually the whole camp was taken away, evacuated, and I was sent to Buchenwald. Buchenwald, by comparison to what we had experienced in Skarzysko and that other company, was, you can't imagine it, but it was like a holiday camp. We got cleaned up. We got striped uniforms, we got clogs to wear on our shoes, on our feet, and it really was a pleasure to be free of the bugs and lice. But we used to go to work as well, but not very hard work. We used to send us down to the quarry, pick up a stone, carry it to another place, and that's how we used to work actually there. But that didn't last for more than 2 weeks, and then we had to go. We were sent again to another munitions factory. And that was in Schlieben. And Schlieben was a place about equidistant from about Berlin, Leipzig, and Dresden. They're about 60 miles apart. And that's where we were. And of course, we were making completely different ammunition there. It was used to call the Panzerfaust, like a bazooka. A bomb. It could only travel about 60 meters, that's all. But it was lethal actually onto the for the tanks. And that's how we worked there. And gradually over the night shifts were very, very pleasant because the air raids were continuing, so we didn't have any lights on. And so night shifts were very good, and during the day of course, we had to go and work normally. Although if you could see the American planes flying overnight, over day in the daytime, and then at night we knew that the British planes were flying to bomb all the various cities, and we could see when the bomb, when the, those cities were being bombed, the whole sky lit up, was like, it's unbelievable. And then one night the whole factory blew up. We didn't know what it was, but we couldn't hear any planes overhead, but it was sabotage or it was an accident, but the whole factory blew up. And to be in, I was on a day shift, fortunately, but the whole of the night shift, of course, was killed, every one of them. And even the town, Schliebenach, was very, very badly damaged as well. The explosions were going on all night, all night. And we ran out, even the barbed wire fencing was torn apart by those explosions. And we ran out into the field. And but in the morning, we had nowhere to go, so we had to make our way back into the camp. And that's when the hard work really started, rebuilding the factories. They sent, not the Germans, but the Latvian and Lithuanian SS-men. And they were the cruelest men you could possibly imagine. The way they made us work, to clearing the site, pouring another concrete block to put the boilers back in. It was, it was impossible to describe what it was like. And of course, once they built the platforms, I was sent back to do my normal work, which was filling up the bombs with the explosives, this picrine. And that's what that was. There were four boilers on the platform, and two of us were sitting in each boiler. We had an open tap, and we used to pick up a boiler, empty shell, and put the, and fill it up with the explosive and put it out onto a tray to cool, and then taking it away. That's the work we did. And because we were working with poisons without any protective clothing, we were given some, an extra soup, and they called it the poison soup, gift soup. So that's how some people were very envious for giving the extra soup as well. And then fortunately then the work was much easier. All the night shift that was killed were replaced by Hungarian Jews. Those are the only Jews actually left by then in 1944. All the other Jews in Poland were already actually dead or whatever. And that's how, so we got to Hungarian Jews and the food improved. We even had, we didn't afraid to go to the medical center. Everything was much, much better. We even went on a strike there for one day. We went to strike, we asked them, and the Germans came out and said, why are you going to strike? And strike? And said, we can't eat the soup. We got no salt. And the German said, when we get salt, you'll get salt. So there were no trains that couldn't get through, so we had to go back to work. Anyway, eventually the camp was split up again, and I was with the second group to be taken away. And the trains were moving about backwards and forwards from one side to another. And eventually we landed, stopped actually at a very large railway junction. And there were lots of trains parked around there. So in our park, the train we were on was parked next to another train, wagons actually, and somebody found out that there are provisions on the train. So everybody rushed out of our train. Even the Germans didn't mind because they were starving themselves. And I got into a wagon full of oats. I tied my trousers at the bottom and I stuffed the oats down into my trousers, and I board back onto the train. Eventually the train moved off and we finished off into Theresienstadt. In Theresienstadt, that was the beginning of May, maybe just the end of April, but the place was absolutely heaving with people. There was no, that's the last place they could send anybody there. And I found my friend actually, who was sent with the first group away from sleep, and he was sitting there on the ground, and of course I had oats, so we made a small fire. Everybody had a tin plate in a tin cup, and we roasted the oats and we ate kernels. But I was beginning to get very, very sick by then, very sick. I was sent into a hut again, and I was lying there, and then by the 8th of May, the Russian tanks came in, and I was there, and I managed to drag myself off my bunk and move up. I got out onto the road as well, and I could see a lot of Germans actually walking back from their farms, because it was Sudetenland, and so that's what it was. But I had to go make my way back into the camp. Eventually, somebody found me there, and they took me down to a makeshift hospital. And I was very ill. I couldn't talk. My whole body was in a spasm, and I was lying there on the bed. And then my friend, with whom I shared the oats. He was looking for me, and he came into the hospital, and I sat down next to me, and the nurse came over to him. She asked him what was my name, and he gave it my name, and the nurse bent over me, she asked me, have you got a sister called Sarah? And I shook my head, and she said, I'm sure she's alive. I was with her in a camp in Austria until about 6 weeks before, and she was with me then. And then from onwards, of course, I had a name by then, and she looked after me just like her own brother. Gradually, I recovered, and while I was very, very ill and no name, British government has decided to allow about 1,000 youngsters to come to England. And my name wasn't on it because I not particularly wanted to go to England. I had no connections with England. But I said, I don't particularly mind, we not go to England. But then she said, no, you should go. And there's one boy I found that he has found that his father was alive in Poland, and he's going back to his father. And anyway, I eventually recovered, and I came to England in 1945 and on VJ Day. We landed in Windermere, and of course, life became more normal. We had got into the dining room, you could see white bread, and some people actually stuffed their bread into the pockets just in case they're not getting it anymore. But we were assured that we had bread every day. And gradually we started learning English, of course, and then the group of 300 boys were separated and sent to various towns and various hostels. And I, with another 27 boys, were sent up to Scotland for recuperation. We were there for nearly a year, not quite a year, and it was a beautiful place, absolutely magnificent place, Cadross, which is just not far from Loch Lomond, not far from the Firth of Clyde as well, so a beautiful place. And the local authorities sent teachers up as well, to teach us as well. So it was a beautiful place. And then, of course, after a year, we had to go back and we had to start learning a trade, because we were not 15, we were not 16, we were 17. So that's what we did. And I started learning as a dental mechanic, and I was placed with a dentist in Glasgow. And I was very near the Mitchell Library in Glasgow, the reference library. So every lunchtime we used to go to the library, and every evening I went to night classes, and I started learning actually the various subjects. Eventually in 1947, I took my lower examination, which is equivalent to the GCSEs here, and I passed the English for foreign students, I passed German, I failed Polish, and I mathematics, I think some geography as well. Anyway, I passed all my subjects enough to start studying my highest A levels. And in 1 year, in the following year, in 1948, I managed to get the physics, chemistry, and I started, noticed that dynamics is a very similar subject to physics. I started learning that one by myself without going to the evening classes. And that's how it is. I got my qualifications to go to university and apply to university, but they wouldn't accept me then. They said, you got too many ex-servicemen in 1948. And anyway, the British Army needs dentists. So I went down to London and I asked to see if I can get a place in London. And the answer was exactly the same. Come back next year and we'll give you a place. And anyway, I stayed in London for just a little while the Olympics were on. And I went to go and see the opening ceremony and a few athletes as well. And then went back to Glasgow, because that's where my home was. And I found a letter from the Glasgow University that I should come for an interview. I got to the interview there, and they said, we'll give you a place, providing you give us an undertaking that you become a British subject. And after you qualify, you have to go and do your national service. Of course, I gave them an undertaking and qualified in 1953 as a dental surgeon. And of course, the first thing I wanted to do was to see if my sister was alive. But I knew she was alive because when I was in Glasgow in Scotland, actually, we managed to get contact with her and she told me that she's alive and she was married because the Red Cross couldn't find her because she married soon after and changed her name. So they couldn't find her, and my brother's alive, but my brother came back to Poland as well, but he didn't want to stay in Poland. It's too traumatic for him, so he went back to Germany, and went back into the DP camp, and from there he went to America. Anyway, my sisters lived in Israel. They stayed in Poland until 1950, and she had two children in Poland as well. Her husband managed to get his business back from before the war, and so they stayed there. But in 1950, the communists actually took over, so they decided to go to Israel. And that's where I went. I went to Israel for the first time to see my sister in 1953. And after 1953, I had to come back to England. I was there for about a month in Israel. And of course, I was British subject by then because I was 1950. I got my naturalization, and then I waited for to be called up. And eventually, I was called up in April 1949. Then first of all, I had the initial training in the Aldershot, and after that, months there, I was placed into to be dental officer in the Royal Army Medical Corps depot in Crookham. And after 6 months, I was sent back to Germany. Back to Germany to be the officer in charge of a dental center in Brunswick. And that's where I was, and it was very pleasant. The four regiments, Southwest Bolters, the Royal Dragoons, and the Royals, and can't remember the other one then, but the work was pleasant, and the school was there as well, so it was practically like working in a private practice. And then I got married as well in 1954. I married my wife, who came to England as an infant kinder transport. She came in 1939, and she got married. And fortunately, she managed to come out to Germany with me as well. And I managed to get married quarters. I was very lucky, actually, for a national serviceman to get married quarters as well. I managed to get married quarters, and we were there until 1956. 1956, that's right. And in 1956, I was demoted and I came back to England. And of course, we had no home in England. I never had a home of my own, but my wife's sister, she went to there, and we stayed with her for about 2 or 3 weeks, and then we got I started work, got a job straight away, and I started working as a dentist. And but before then, I wanted to work first of all as an assistant, and later on in the same year, in 1956, I opened up my own dental practice in Potter's Bar. And the Potter's Bar, I was there for from 1956 until I retired in 2014. So I was the oldest practicing dentist in the country. And so that's how it was. But we wanted to go and see as well in 1991. I wanted to go and see actually where all our family were perished. And that was in Belzec, a Belzec extermination camp. My two sons and my daughter-in-law, we went to Poland, and we traveled around the various areas, but particularly wanted to go and see Belzec. We found out, we knew by then, that my family were all taken to Belzec and perished. And we got there, and it was a terrible state, terrible shock as well. There was nobody there, just a rusty gate, and only indication that there was a camp there was they had like six urns to represent the 600,000 Jews who were killed there. And the dogs were running around, digging up the bones. It was a horrendous sight, a really horrendous sight. And that's where the last place for my parents was. And then we went back again in a few years later, and the camp was completely different then, because the Americans, the Polish government brought forensic archaeologists, and they found that there were 11 mass graves there, and they managed to make the graves more secure, and that's what it was. But it was completely different actually, because the place, there's a museum there as well now. They've got the place, we've got the stones going right around the place of all the places from where the people were brought to Belzec in order to exterminate them. They didn't come just from Poland, they came from as far as Hungary and Greece as well. It's just a horrendous place. There were 600,000 people killed there. And the method of killing there, those people were just, a train used to arrive there with 2,000 people every day, every 2 hours actually. And they unloaded people very, very quickly, and that herded them in into a hut, which was airtight. And they had two Russian engines, the tank engines attached to the tank, to the hut, and they had carbon monoxide actually shoved them into the tank, and that's how they were killed. So that's how it happened to all those people there. Anyway, that is my story up till now. I've got 6 children, and I've got 4 children, 2 sons and 2 daughters, and I've got 8 grandchildren. So we're very, very, all of them are very happy, and we are very working. And I'm glad I came to England rather than go anywhere else. So my sister, she was in Israel, and she died 92 years ago when she was 91. And she's got a large family over there in Israel. So she's we got something actually to be grateful for. Thank you very much.